Dick Harrington, the former and now retired CEO of Thomson Reuters, was in London on the day that the Twin Towers in New York were attacked. He was there with his entire management team, and Thomson lost 11 employees that day. And Dick made a series of decisions within hours, and in spite of the difficulty in communications, he was able to contact the families of the employees that had been killed, and he immediately assured the surviving spouses that they would have a salary continuation for 2 more years. He immediately, of course, approved and said that Thomson would pay for short-term food service and transportation and that sort of thing for the family during this difficult time. And then he said, and Thomson will also pay for the college tuitions of all of your children. I saw Dick about 6 weeks later, and I said, Dick, did you talk to your legal department before you made that decision? And he said, no. And I said, did you talk to your board? And he said, no. He said, you know, if they didn't like it, they could fire me. He said, it was just simply the right thing to do. Well, we discovered a number of leaders in our research over the years that were people like Dick Harrington. They have this sort of it's like muscle memory. When they're in any kind of a situation to make a decision about the welfare of other people, it's automatically a decision for the benefit of other people. And that's what Dick did. I'd like to tell you a little bit of the story behind the research that ended up in our book called The Return on Character that was published in April of this year. About 15 years ago, I was sitting in the office of a client of mine. He was the executive vice president of American Express, and he was in charge of the field force of the financial planners of American Express. They had like 12,000 people across the country. His name was Doug Lennick. Doug was a pioneer in using emotional intelligence assessment tools for assessing the emotional intelligence of the trainees and also using it as a selection tool. And he said to me one that day, he said, Fred, he said, an interesting thing. He said, there's a subset of the trainees that he said score very high on emotional intelligence, but they score very low on the one scale that measures integrity. He said, what do you make of that? And I said, well, it sounds to me like you found a way to identify the con artists among us, because if you think about that, people that are con artists or take you into, instill your confidence in you easily, are people that have very good emotional intelligence skills, very good influencing skills. But they are, at the same time, perhaps removing the wallet from your back pocket. So, of course, he eliminated them from the study. But we went on to discuss that, and we decided that maybe there was something missing from the emotional intelligence model. Maybe a sort of a deeper level of intelligence that would serve as sort of the foundation for all of the influencing skills. And the more we talked about that, the more we decided that maybe that was something we would call moral intelligence. And then we decided, realized we probably weren't the first guys that ever thought about that. And so we hired a researcher to pore through the literature, including ancient philosophy, modern philosophy, evolutionary psychology, theories of child development, theories of moral development, and also got into the recent writings in the neurosciences about human nature. And then we stumbled across some interesting findings in the field of cultural anthropology. It was in the neurosciences, though, that we discovered that, you know, in the 1980s, basically, the theory was that the human infant is born as sort of a blank slate, and that it's all nurture that accounts for who they turn out to be. And then as the sophistication in brain research got more sophisticated in genetics, It is really pretty well concluded today that that human infants are not a blank slate. They are, in fact, born to be moral. They're born to connect with other people. It's the top agenda for a new infant to connect with its mother, its caregiver. They begin to bond with their mother when they're yet in the womb to the mother's voice. So that was interesting. We sort of had courage to face into that. And second thing that we found that was really quite interesting was from the field of cultural anthropology. We discovered there's a book that was written in the 1990s by Donald Brown, a cultural anthropologist, called Human Universals. And it's basically an encyclopedia of what all cultures around the globe, regardless of ethnicity or location, have in common. And what they have in common are a certain set of universal moral principles that all parents in the world, regardless of where they are, teach their children the behaviors in their culture that express integrity. They teach their children the behaviors that express responsibility. And they also teach them within their social group to be forgiving and to be compassionate, to care for people. And we reasoned that these four moral principles would probably be pretty important for leaders, that the leaders that we had known that had been very successful were leaders who demonstrated this in their leadership behavior, and in fact, we claimed that they would probably achieve better long-term financial results. We created a leadership model around this, and actually wrote a book that was published by Wharton Business Press in 2005 called Moral Intelligence, and in that book we made this claim that leaders who demonstrated these four moral principles would in fact get better long-term business results than those who didn't. The book is in six or seven other languages. It's in German, by the way, and it was updated in 2011 as a second edition when it came out. We got a lot of good reviews from the press about the book when it came out, but I had one reviewer who called me up and he said, "Look, Fred," he said, "you know, I know that you like all that soft stuff." He said, "You're a psychologist after all, stands to reason." But he said, "Let me give you a little lesson in economics." He said, "What really creates value is the business model, and all that soft stuff that you think is so important will come along and fall into place if the business model is profitable. If it makes a lot of money, it'll be able to attract the right kind of talent and all of that." And he said, "You know, even if it doesn't fall into place, as long as management stays legal," he said, "that's all that really matters." He said, "You know, it's nice to have, don't get me wrong, it's nice to have, but it's not required. It's sort of icing on the cake, if you will." And he said, "And besides," and then he kind of threw down the gauntlet, he said, "I read your book," and he said, "you don't have any data to support your claim." He said, "All you did was interview a bunch of people that agreed with you." And, you know, he was right that we didn't have any data, but I was convinced that he was wrong, that the character of leadership did not really matter as long as management's team stayed legal. So that was the sort of the motivation to do this research. This was 9 years ago now, back in 2006, and over the next 7 years, after we launched the research, we enrolled 121 CEOs and their senior teams in the research, and we ended up with data sets on 84 of these organizations. And a data set included a deep level of interviewing on a personal as well as professional level with the CEO themselves, asking the CEO to fill out a whole bunch of survey forms that we created for the research about self-observations about their behavior as well as about their beliefs and their worldview. But where we got the really interesting data was we asked each of the CEOs to give us access to a random sample at all layers of the organization of 300 employees. And then I asked those employees to rate the behaviors of the CEO and the senior team and some aspects of the organization. We ended up with almost 8,500 employee observations on those 84 CEOs. And just to jump to the big picture, here's the primary findings. I think what surprised us the most, we expected a difference in the profitability of the firms led by high character teams and CEOs compared to low character, but we didn't expect that it would be almost five times greater. That result started to show up in the middle of the research, and I thought, well, our sample isn't big enough yet, and so we went on. And the results just got stronger the more data that we added. Strong character teams also enjoyed a 26% higher level of workforce engagement. They had a lower overall corporate risk profile. They had fewer legal incidents. They had lower audit fees as a percentage of revenue. And they also had the top character leaders had no tone at the top citations by their auditors at all. And then somewhat surprising was that the the employees of these CEOs and of their teams viewed the strong character CEOs as being more skilled with regard to their business skills than the lower character ones. We're not sure that there's a real difference in actual skill level, but I'll talk a little bit more about that in a minute. Well, before we could really begin this study, we had to come to a better understanding of what we mean when we're talking about business results. And on our board of advisors is a professor of accounting from Duke University, and he gave me a lesson in this whole field. He said, look, he said, for years, he said, the academic accounting professors have been trying, their students have been trying to parse out the variance around these three factors, macroeconomic factors, the business model, and what's now called the leadership effect. He said, originally, when we were doing this research years ago, he said, we'd always come up with error variance left over from after we accounted for the business model and macroeconomic effects. And he said, in the early years, we called that error variance. And he said, then as we got more sophisticated, we realized it's really the leadership. So we started calling it the CEO effect. He said, and now it's broadened so that we're calling it the leadership effect. And we know that it accounts for a significant amount of variance. Some academic studies claim that it accounts up to 30% of the variance of outcomes is due to the leadership, the management effect. We know that investment analysts claim that they place about 30% of their decisions on whether or not to invest in a company based on their assessment of the quality of senior management. The problem is that academics don't know what's in that third box. They call it a black box. And there's been a lot of studies on that about aspects of personality. There's been studies to see if narcissistic CEOs get better results or worse results than others. There's been all kinds of studies done on all of these factors. And none of them have turned out to be particularly significant. We also looked at several of those factors. We sorted our data by education, by tenure. We had information on the political behavior of the CEOs in our study. We sorted on that, on their career path, on early family history, all of those. None of them turned out to be any significant differences with regard to return on assets, except for the type of the or size of the organization. Larger organizations consistently delivered a higher level of return on assets or profitability than did the smaller organizations. And, you know, you think of several reasons for that. Larger businesses have been in business longer, have more proven business models, et cetera. But when we looked at the leadership within those, it was always the strong character leaders that contributed the most profitability, even in the smaller companies. So that was explained that. But when we sorted on these four character habit areas, these four moral principles and the behaviors that the leaders demonstrated for those, it immediately popped out this big difference on return on assets. So this is what we settled in on is the conviction that your behavior is a reflection of your character. How you treat other people is a reflection. And just think of someone that you know that you would that you view as a principled, strong character person. Why do you view them that way? Well, it's because of how they behave. They're probably people that consistently tell the truth. They keep their promises, stand up for what's right. They own up to their own mistakes and accept consequences of their own personal choices and decisions. And when somebody else makes a well-intentioned mistake, they don't shame and blame. They act, their first response is to be curious. And they treat people as people, not as objects or as numbers. And when you think of somebody like that, that you know, you think that they're a strong, high-character person because of that behavior that they show. We decided that the best way to measure the character then of the CEOs and the senior teams in our study was to come up with behavioral indicators around those four moral principles. And we did. We came up with 65 behavioral indicators. Some were positive and some were negative. as the study went on, we realized through statistical analysis that there was only 25 of them that was really needed. If you added any more, it didn't really change the character score. So we ended up with 25 of those behavioral indicators. And then we were able to combine them into one score so that we could come up with a character score for a senior team or for a CEO or team leader. And then we were able to rank order those, and we found that we had a nice spread between all of the 84 in our study, from those that were fairly low up to those that were fairly high. And we put them on a curve with, on the x-axis are all of the individuals in rank order, and on the y-axis is the strength of their character score. And then we moved on to comparing and looking at the differences between these two extreme groups. Those at the top we ended up calling the virtuoso CEOs. They were the ones that were the CEOs that their employees said of these four moral principles, they almost always tell the truth. They almost always stand up for what's right. They almost always own up to their own mistakes. They are forgiving and compassionate almost always. Their first response is to be concerned about the welfare of others, like Dick Harrington in my first story. Contrasted to those at the bottom of the curve, who we ended up calling the self-focused CEOs for some obvious reasons, and they were ones that the employees said, well, they tell the truth, yeah, about half the time, which is another way of saying that they lie to us about half the time. And they said, caring for us as people, treating us as people, less than half the time. We're mostly a number to them. And when we probed deeper into the worldviews of these two groups of leaders, the ones at the top, the virtuoso leaders, were ones that never seemed to come up on the screen what was important or for them or their careers, or they were not concerned about their compensation. They were concerned about delivering value to the bottom line for all of the stakeholders that they were working for. Whereas these at the bottom were mostly concerned about their own welfare and their own financial security. They were very clear about that. I'd like to tell you about each one in each of these categories just to make this come to life a little bit more for you. This is Jim Senegal, the retired now CEO of Costco Wholesale, which is the second largest retailer in the world, next to Walmart. I was interesting when I pulled up these statistics to notice that Europe and the U.S. kind of split. There's about five in the U.S. and five in Europe, and three of them are German companies, the largest retailers. But when Jim launched Costco Wholesale in 1985, he decided that it was very important to honor three promises. And the first was a promise that he would make to the future customers, the members. It's a member model, a retail member model. And that is that he would never bring them anything but quality merchandise and would never mark it up more than 15%. And the second promise he made was to the employees that we will pay you a living wage and we will treat you respectfully and provide you with a good work environment. And the third was to investors that you'll get a reasonable return on your dollar. If you had invested $1,000 in Costco when it went public in 1985, you would have $60,000, American dollars now, and you would have enjoyed a 16.4% annual compound return rate. So in terms of the return to shareholders, you know, he knocked it out of the park. Also, employees are the most satisfied bunch of people I've ever encountered. I have a personal hobby of going into Costco warehouses wherever I am, just to see if I can find a disgruntled Costco employee. And so far, I haven't had any luck. I mean, a small sample, but it's a fun kind of pastime. You know, you kind of get into a conversation with, like, the checkout clerk. How long you worked at Costco? Oh, about 3 or 4 years. And how do you like working here? The response I always get is, oh, I love it. You know, I mean, that's kind of an unusual response for somebody in a retail checkout lane, or somebody serving hot dogs at the food counter. Oh, I love it. Why do you love it so much? Well, and they talk about the great pay and benefits. And true to his promise, Costco does pay its workers much better than others in the retail area. They pay an average of $22 an hour for the average warehouse worker compared to Walmart's about 10 or 8 or 9, 10, something in that area. And so they after they talk about the great pay and benefits, then I probe a little further. Well, is there anything else you like about it? Oh, I love the people here, especially my manager. My manager has my back. I love my manager. Well, how often do you hear people in the front line talking about loving their managers? I mean, it's pretty unusual. One guy was serving hot dogs, had a hairnet on and all that, and he told me that same thing. I said, so you're serving hot dogs? And he said, yeah, I know. He said, you know, this is temporary. He said, you know, my manager and I are talking about it. He's looking for opportunities for me. He said, he's got my back. He says, I know he cares about this, cares about me. And then I said, what did you do before you went to work for Costco? He said, oh, I taught high school. So, shows you a little bit of something about our values in our country when we pay more for somebody to serve a hot dog than we do to teach our children, but that's another subject of another lecture. Let me tell you then about another one at the bottom of the curve that illustrates the differences. And I'll call him Tom for obvious reasons, is that we don't want to identify him. But when I first walked into his office, the thing that surprised me, I've been in a lot of CEOs' offices, and the one that surprised me is that this office didn't have any more room on the walls for another picture of him and somebody famous or somebody playing golf with him. I mean, the office was a shrine to him and his success. And that put me off a little bit, but, you know, in talking to him, I came out of there convinced it was a great company. He was so enthused about the culture that he had established, and he was the founder. It was now a Fortune 500 company and all of that. And this was about the time the financial collapse was happening in 2008. And so we asked for a random sample of 300 employees, sent out the survey to them, and that survey told a different story. There was, I think, about 60% of the respondents claimed that it was not safe to tell the truth to senior management. Another 40% viewed senior management as willing to alter the financial results if need be in order to make their bonuses, et cetera. I mean, there was just a great, huge distrust in management and in this, quote, wonderful culture that he had created. And when I came back to give him the report, like I say, it was in the midst of the financial crisis. He was too busy to see me, so he handed me off to his head of human resources, a guy that had been there about 20 years. And I started going over the results to him, and I noticed his face sort of getting clouding up and getting a frown on it. And he stopped me and he said, where did you get this data? And I said, well, it was a random sample of your employees. And he said, well, we've been doing our internal surveys every year for years. And he said, Tom and his group always get the highest marks on integrity. He said, there's got to be something wrong with your research design. And he basically ended the conversation, and I wasn't really escorted out of the building, but it kind of felt like it. And, you know, kind of forgot about it. Then about 6 or 8 weeks later, I picked up a copy of the Wall Street Journal, and there was an article. Tom and his entire management team had been fired by the board of directors, whole team fired. And then it was only a matter of about 8 weeks after that that the board decided to sell off business unit after business unit, and they finally sold off the whole company into pieces and broke it up. Well, not every self-focused CEO has a story that ends like that. In fact, most of them were successful CEOs, and they did bring some profitability to the bottom line. But with being self-focused has its liabilities. Warren Buffett, a great American investor, said once that when the tide goes out, you can tell who's not wearing swimming trunks. And the tide went out on Tom and his company and exposed all the operating weaknesses and all of the overexposure to risk that he had ignored. So I got a question for you. Who do you think you are more like, Jim, the virtuoso CEO, or Tom, the self-focused CEO? We discovered in our research that about 80% of people overestimate the level of their quality of their character, and that most people have a significant blind spot, that if you were to ask 30 people who know you well enough to rate you on our 25 character items, chances are pretty good, about 80% anyway, that you would come in as viewing yourself as being a person of a higher character than the data would actually show. Now, your reputation score may not be your true character. It may be that this is just a reflection of some ways that people, it's resulting in how they're viewing you or whatever. But it does reflect your reputation. And perception is reality in that sense, and how people deal with you is based on their reputation. Overrating your own character habits is a common cognitive bias. It's called the illusory superiority bias. And when anybody is asked to measure or to rate themselves on almost any quality, they always claim that they're above average. And most people will claim that they're in the top 10 or 15%. So this wasn't unusual. The ones in our study, though, it was interesting. The two groups, the virtuoso CEOs and the self-focused CEOs, ended up rating themselves almost exactly the same. The average score for the two groups was only 1 point apart. They both rated themselves up in the high character range. When the employee ratings came in, it told a different story. You can see that the virtuoso CEOs were rated by their employees as being even stronger character than the CEOs rated themselves, showing a certain amount of humility. I think Jim Collins, in his book Good to Great, talks about that as humility as being a quality of the level five leader. And I think these are a big overlap between his level five leader research and our research. And the self-focused leaders, a big blind spot. There was close to 20-point difference in their scores. Another way of looking at this is here. These are the self ratings of the virtuoso CEOs, and as you can see, one was pretty hard on himself, and they're kind of spread across the curve. And here are the self ratings of the self-focused CEOs, and they're mostly up in the middle to high middle of the curve. And here's what happens to those ratings when the employees rate them, is that they show a different picture. So most of us are not a good judge of character, either of our own character. And I would say that most people are not a very good judge of other people's character, especially in selection situations where people are charged with selecting a leader for a new position. People can be very good at interviewing, and when people base their judgment of their character of the person based on that interview experience, I would say that what they are really rating is the person's emotional intelligence skills, and not really rating their character. So one thing that became clear to us as our work progressed is that how you display your character is a matter of habit. That, you know, you don't stop and think before you came in the room today about how you were going to greet somebody. You just automatically do it as your habitual way of greeting people. And we claim that these 25 behavioral indicators and those four moral principle boxes are basically matters of habit that you acquire over the years. And sometimes you maybe acquire some habits that aren't so helpful. But habits, by definition, operate below the level of consciousness so that you are unaware of how you treat other people. And other people, if you have some annoying habits that irritate and annoy other people, chances are pretty good they're not going to tell you what they are, because people don't like to confront other people about that. If you have a very close friend and you make it very, very safe, they might venture into that territory a little bit. But the point is that most of us have some annoying habits of how we treat other people that are below our level of awareness, and until we find out what they are, we can't do anything about it. But the good thing is that habits can be strengthened and they can be replaced. Another interesting finding that we came up with is that the senior team, or the team, is actually more important than the team leader in terms of results. And if you think about it for a minute, it makes sense. It's the senior team that really engages the workforce, the senior team that really, you know, the ones that structure the organization, they're the ones that that establish the conditions for organizational dynamics and for for workforce engagement. But our data showed that there was much higher correlations between the character habits of the senior team and these outcome measures than there was for the team leader. Another interesting finding, or major finding, is that character either undermines or magnifies the impact of leadership or business skills. And we have come up with a way of looking at that, and that is that who is the circle that is about your character habits, who you are as a person. And of course, there's other aspects such as personality and all that, but we found through this research that your unconscious habits of how you treat other people reflects your character, and that's the big powerful factor in the who part of this equation. The what part is your skills that you're here at business school, some of you, to learn skills of how to create value. And it's who plus what equals the impact and results. But what is interesting is that it's not just an additive relationship. It's just not that plus that. It's really an exponential relationship that that character serves as the platform on which skills rest, and that the higher the platform, the greater the impact the skills have. The lower that platform, weak character, it undermines those skills. And we have some data that will illustrate that. These are the ratings that the employees gave for the skills of the self-focused CEOs and the conditions for workforce engagement that they've created, and as you've already seen, for the level of profitability. And then when we add character to it, you can see that skills, their estimation of the skills of them go up significantly. Workforce engagement goes up quite dramatically. And as you've seen before, the profitability goes up as well. So as I said, I think the way this works is that character serves as a platform on which skills can impact the results. Strong character teams really are teams that engage and inspire a workforce. And they do it by creating a set of workforce engagement conditions in an organization. Gallup has done a number of years, have done surveys on workforce engagement for about the last 15 years. And when they first did it, everybody was shocked when they found out that both in Europe and the United States, about 70% of the workforce claimed not to be engaged. They didn't really look forward to coming to work. They just kind of put in their time. In fact, a certain percentage of that 70% did more than come to work disengaged. They often were actively disengaged, trying to bring harm to the company. But what's really interesting is that these numbers haven't budged over the years. The 2014 results, about 70%. So you want to ask, why in the world is that the case? Because senior management obviously gets it, that this is important. They see the connection between workforce engagement and workforce productivity and the bottom line and all of that. So why haven't they done something about it? Well, we think it's because the thing that really drives engagement is character. And senior management teams all view themselves as people of being of high character. Why wouldn't they? We have that cognitive bias that rates us in that way. And they have it never occurs to them to look at themselves as anything that's a barrier to workforce engagement. but when they do look at themselves, then a whole different dynamic comes into play. High character senior teams are ones that are able to create these conditions that if they are present, you will have a highly engaged workforce. And if you look at these, you can see that low character leaders are not apt to be able to create an environment where people feel respected or cared and support. The organizational energy is probably not very high. They probably don't have much confidence in management. And in fact, the data that we gathered from the two groups showed this big differences on these dimensions, that the amount of respect, fairness, there was often charges of favoritism with regard to compensation and recognition and hiring practices on the low character teams, etc. So to repeat, when people become engaged, the results really flow to the bottom line. So character is the quality that we believe that makes a difference in helping a company thrive. I want to talk a little bit about competition, because everybody faces competition in these days. If you're in the business world, you're competing with other businesses for euros or dollars on the revenue line. If you're in a nonprofit, you're competing for the attention of donors. If you're a political party, you're competing for votes. If you're a dean of a business school, you're competing for the most desirable students, etc. So competition is a fact of life. And when you look at this model again, your competitors all have the same macroeconomic factors to deal with that you have. They probably have a business model that's very similar to yours, or you are probably not able to differentiate yourself there. But where you can differentiate yourself is with regard to the character of the leadership. And so you might be asking, how can I do something about that? Well, we have installed a process in companies that we work with that's called an annual character audit. And what this amounts to is that we want to focus primarily on teams, not as on individuals. And we ask, it's best if you start with the top team in an organization. And through a process of surveying on these 25 behavioral indicators items, of asking their direct reports and their direct reports, and often even individuals from a third layer down, to rate the character habits of the senior team. And that sets up a whole dynamic in the organization that is quite interesting, and has had very positive results for the ones that we've used it with. And we've got 10 new companies in the process of doing that right now. One that we did 3 or 4 years ago was a large staff function in a national firm in the United States. They had like 600 people. It was in the HR department. They had 600 people in that department. And the senior team were people that, and I believe they were people of in, their intentions were to be people of great depth of character, strong character. And they rated themselves an average of 88 on our scale, so their average rating was even higher than our virtuosos rated themselves. And when we showed them the results of the survey, their direct reports had rated them down in the 60s. I mean, a big gap between their view of themselves and how their direct reports, they were just stunned. Our direct reports said this about us? They were just, jaws were dropped as a result of that. And the more that they processed that, they concluded that we have so many other pressing things on our agenda, but we have to pay attention to this. We have to do something about this. So what they ended up doing with our advice and help is that each of them ended up having a meeting with their direct report teams, and they shared the data with them. They showed them what the data was, and they talked about their dismay at finding out that they were viewed this way when they viewed themselves so differently. And they basically apologized to their teams, and then they asked for help. Well, you know, the first response was stunned silence on the part of their teams. But then people became very engaged, and they didn't immediately change their assessment of the character strength of their bosses, of the people in the senior team, but they were willing to listen and to talk and to help them make changes. Some of the biggest changes that the senior team made was that they quit trying to do everything themselves and got much more trusting and much more empowering and engaged their direct report teams. 2 years later, we reassessed where they had come, and their character score had gone up 21%. The confidence that people in the organization expressed in management was 17% improvement, and the workforce engagement score went up by 18%. So we've helped a number of organizations now get into this cultural habit of annually doing a culture audit or a character audit of themselves as a way of keeping themselves focused on this previously invisible factor that we think is so effective and or so powerful with the impact that it has on the impact of the business skills. There are three steps that these companies have each gone through. And the first step is that with finding the blind spots, called popping the bubble or getting out of your little world and seeing how the rest of the organization really views you. I think this is such an endemic situation with regard to senior management teams in almost all companies, especially the bigger companies, is that they live in their own world. General Motors, of course, has been in the news over the years a lot. In our country, the previous administration of General Motors was set up so that the senior executive team had absolutely no contact with anybody other than each other. They parked in their own garage. They had elevators that took them up to their own executive suite. They had to go through security glass doors, two or three barriers to get into their offices. They never saw anybody except maybe a security guard at the entrance of the building. That was how isolated they had become in their own bubble, and as we know what happened ultimately to General Motors and the troubles they had. But the second is, once they find blind spots, is each of these teams had to discover their own motivation. How important is it to me or to us that we really do something about this. And once they became convinced, and you could see the connection between this and the impact on results, and also just the dissonance of being viewed in this way that was so different from how they viewed themselves, it provided often the motivation to do something about it. But then the third thing that is really just absolutely required is to go public. It's one of the things that senior executives least like to do, is to become vulnerable and to own up in front of their workforce that there are things that perhaps I don't know how to do best, that maybe you know how to do better than I do. And furthermore, there are ways that perhaps I've been unintentionally treating people that I need to change. So these three steps are what companies did. So question is how this sort of a culture of annual character audits, how can that be helpful and who does it help? Well, it can really be an important part of succession planning. If you are trying to make decisions on the promotion of somebody and you have a picture of their particular character reputation, so this obviously this audit can be done for individuals as well as for teams. It's a way of identifying high potential leaders, for example. I think most leadership development programs are focused on skills. Action learning programs are great, but they're all focused on skills. And what about the impact that the character, as we know, has on skills that could be built into leadership development programs? If boards were to pay more attention to the character and an objective assessment of character, they would make fewer drastic mistakes of choosing people that people are almost at the senior level are hired for their skills and they're fired for their character. I mean, it's sort of, and then talent managers, to the extent that you have a plan to try to change the culture of an organization, if you embed in this discipline of an annual character audit, believe me, it will have quite an impact on the organization. So in conclusion, there are four things that I hope you remember when you leave today. And the first is that the character of the team is more important than the character of the individual leader of the team. You can have a strong character senior team that can protect the workforce from kind of a toxic CEO, for example. It probably won't last for a long time from a sustainability standpoint because members of the strong character team will begin to get tired of that kind of work and will probably leave and go to work somewhere else, but they can do that. So likewise, a very strong character CEO with a low character team is not a formula for success either. We found some of those in our study and disqualified them from the virtuoso category because of their quality of their team. There was one CEO in particular that had that, and I showed him the results, and he said, "Oh, I know why the team's getting such low marks. It's because of so-and-so," and he mentioned one person. He said, "He's pretty tough on people." And I said, "Well, why haven't you done anything about that?" "Well, I don't know, you know," he said, "it's just kind of hard to do this kind of thing." So he was exposing sort of his lack of skill in being able to hold people accountable. The second thing I hope you remember is the fact that character and skills are not just an additive equation, it's an exponential equation, that character serves as that platform, it magnifies skills. And third is that character is a matter of habit. How you treat other people is a matter of habit, and thus habits can be changed, and in that sense, character can be taught. So thank you, I hope you remember these four points, and we'll continue our discussion.
I'd like to pose a question or two and then open things up to the floor. I guess thinking as a researcher about the character measure, I was struck by the fact that you're focused on the mean, sort of the average or the sum across the 25 questions. It made me wonder what you do with those who might exhibit more variance. So I was thinking about another business philosopher who had defined maturity is the balance between courage and consideration. Mm-hmm. But there may be some people that have more courage than consideration and more others that have more consideration than courage. So how have you dealt with those who might be stronger on the head dimension than on the heart and vice versa? There must be some unevenness that you deal with, and I'm curious about how you deal with that.
There are. We were able to come up with a score in each of those four categories, for a score for integrity, a score for responsibility, et cetera. And in general, it's easier to get higher scores on integrity than it is on compassion. Compassion seems to be the thing that's least honored. And so I think that's reflective of our culture, is that, you know, when we wrote our first book in 2005, you know, people said, seriously, you're going to talk about forgiveness and compassion in a business book on leadership? Are you guys nuts? And we said, yeah, well, maybe we are, but we think it's pretty important. And, you know, all you have to do is talk in any kind of a focus group to employees, and compassion is a thing that, that they place at the top of the list. And compassion doesn't mean, you know, soupy kind of soft stuff. It means paying attention to who they are as people and treating them as people. And that's what's so important to people, is they want to, we want to feel human, connected.
I'll have certainly another question or two. Why don't we open things up right away? And anyone who would like to jump in, please raise a hand and we will call you out.
So my name is Joachim. I think it's a great analysis, and I think it's really, you know, a great piece of work. I'm not quite sure whether I agree with the conclusion that you can, you know, by changing habits, do you change character, or do you just make people like actors, you know, who kind of display something to the outside world, which they are not really. Mm-hmm. And I'm wondering whether you might, you know, these are all intelligent people you're talking about, you know, CEOs, they are there for a reason. Mm-hmm. And they are able to change their habits based on a perceived need to change them. Yeah? Mm-hmm. And the question is, will that really change their character and their underlying intentions, or will it just display something to the outside world that they want to see?
It's certainly possible for people to change their behavior and not change their heart. And, you know, we have two different ways of working with individuals is different than helping a team change its perception, the perception of their character, reputation. But when you're working with individuals, you know, if you can't get the person to really look at their life as a whole, and we know a lot about what integrated human beings look like, that have a coherent life narrative, and that they have a mental complexity that is reflective of being a fully integrated person. Those kind of helping people go along that pathway as individuals will identify those that are willing to change their character, not just their behavior. The thing about changing just the behavior is it doesn't last, generally. So, yeah. But, you know, people can change their character in the sense that transformational change happens all the time in the lives of human beings. Some people go along like this for all along, and suddenly some wake-up call will happen in their life. Maybe it's a big disappointment or something like that that happens, and there'll be a transformational change. You know, years ago we used to call that the midlife crisis, but it happens, you know, at any stage of people's lives, and people do make major transformational changes in who they are as people.
Hi, I'm Karen. I work here for the Career Services. I was just wondering, because you talked about compassion and also the leadership effect, and you mentioned some studies that were done when it comes to, I forgot totally the word right now, sorry. When it comes to narcissism and empathy, I'm sorry. And then also some new psychological findings, for example, when it comes to, I read about the amygdala and how they react to certain situations in leadership. And I was wondering, because there's also something going on right now, a lot in studies with psychopaths versus leadership. Mm-hmm. What is your take on that?
Well, you know, something like 4% of the population are psychopaths, and that there is evidence that their brains are actually different and developed in a different way. But what's so true about them is that they have no capacity for feeling empathy with anybody else. I actually gave have you heard of TED Talks? I gave a TEDx talk 2 or 3 years ago called Psychopaths in the C-Suite, where I talk about that. The fact is that most senior executive suites are not made up of people that you would identify as psychopaths, because most psychopaths are so dysfunctional. that they can't manage to get up very far in an organization. But there are those that are on the continuum. They wouldn't be classified as a psychopath, but they're getting close there. They have no problem in using people. And unfortunately, a lot of those do get into the senior suite. All you have to do is talk to people two or three layers down about the senior level, and they say, how in the world do that person ever get up there? Don't they know? Don't the people above them know? Well, the answer is no, they don't, because they're very good at dealing, managing upward. But psychopaths, you know, if once in a while they get through, they get through in high potential programs, they get selected in various roles of people that are on that psychopathic plane. And this is why a good solid character assessment would weed them out or would force them. I think all incoming MBA students should be required to take a course on character development, and the beginning thing would be to have a character audit done for yourself. See where, I mean, if you're here to learn the skills of creating value and you know how important character is as part of that equation for your skills, why wouldn't you want to do everything you could to become a graduate with not only a high grade point average, but a high character performance average as well?
Yes. I sometimes wonder what power can do to character. Because we have heard so many times that, now that she or he has got the power, he has totally changed his character. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Used to be really a very approachable kind of person, and then all of a sudden he's, you know, prominent and he's got a lot of power, maybe money, I don't know. But then we say, okay, change of character has taken place. Mm-hmm. So what is happening there? You have never mentioned this word.
I suspect my colleague knows a lot more about that than I do because he's done a lot of research on status. But what I would suggest is that people that behave that way when they get into higher positions of power aren't really people of high character. Otherwise, they wouldn't behave that way. Dick Harrington, the story I told about him at the beginning, I got to know him pretty well over the years. And one of his colleagues said, you know, when we have a holiday party, he said, you know, it's hard to get Dick to spend time to the people that we want him to spend time with because he's over talking to the food service person. that distinction of status just didn't mean anything to him, nor did it to Jim Senegal. Jim Senegal was not a person that, if you went into the, and I did go into the executive suite at Costco International at their world headquarters, and there's this carpet that's kind of worn at the edges and old steel cabinets. And Jim didn't even have a real office. He had sort of a corner of a space in the executive suite with a half wall around it. But there was none of the trappings of I'm important in a big position. No mahogany walls with fresh flowers every day and there's executive chef or anything. That just wasn't there. Can you speak a little louder? I don't think anybody can hear.
That humility sort of balances it out.
Yes, right.
In German, we would say Demut, mm-hmm. Which is a character.
Yeah, the thing that so typified the virtuoso CEOs was their humility and their willingness. Their first assumption is that there's something I don't know and that I need to learn. And they made it very safe for people to give them feedback. And they were very reluctant to. You know, they just avoided the perks. They wouldn't even think about corporate jets and all of that unless there was a good cost reason to do it so that, you know, it was cheaper than other flight or better, but it was not for the perks of that. So humility is a very important part of it.
I'm wondering how much does the external environment and the current situation or current reality of an individual influence his character in the good way or in a bad way?
We all know the power of peer pressure. There's been a lot of social psychology studies that have shown that you can take people of high character, put them in an environment where they begin, all their peer group begins to say, oh, that's just the way we do it around here. Everybody does that. Don't worry, and all of that. And yes, and people will get caught up in that. But you know, peer pressure can work the other way around, too. And that's why how the strong character companies instill the strong character culture down into the organization is through peer pressure. At Costco example, I know so much about Costco, I like to use them as an example. They have a shrink rate, which is the way of describing the loss that retailers experience through goods that are lost, damaged, or stolen. And it turns out that most shrink in the retail world is because of employee theft. Well, Costco has a shrink rate that is 20% of the average for the retail world. And it's because their culture is such that there's peer pressure at the bottom. Is it employee sees another employee stealing, they tell on them, they report them. Don't steal from our company. You know, I mean, it's that kind of peer pressure.
I mean, it can also, interestingly, I think, work, and this could be a nice next step, perhaps. You mentioned that peer pressure can work the other way. A second way in which it can work the other way is that if, as you as a person of strong character, find yourself around others who are not sharing those beliefs and values, you, because you've so deeply identified with character, you actually ratchet up your commitment to your morality because you see this as a challenge to your core beliefs that you must fend off. So having slightly immoral peers might have you know, a different kind of peer effect.
Right.
You have met many of the virtuoso CEOs. How did you experience them? Are these the nice guys for who those it's important that everybody feels well? Or what is their attitude and their behavior around performance?
Yeah, you know, that's a good question, Martin. I'm glad you asked it. In that, don't make any mistake about it, these virtuoso CEOs were the epitome of the hard-driving, focused, bottom-line, bring in the results kind of people. And they added the part about treating people as people. And they knew that the best way to do that is by energizing, motivating people, getting them to work with them to do that. You know, there's, in at least in American English, there's a big discussion about the hard skills and the soft skills. And that's a false comparison because it's hard plus hard. The ideal image that's promoted in the United States often by the business press and even by some business schools, I think, is the idea that the ideal person that we turn out, business executive, is the one that's the hard-driving, hard-nosed, kind of take-no-prisoners kind of person. And if they're a little rough on people, well, you know, that sort of comes with the territory. They bring in the numbers. Well, I think that's just patently wrong. I mean, they're people that are crippled because they are only doing part of the equation. If they were to add the other hard, for them, it'd be harder stuff to learn of the character dimensions, then they would have a much better impact. You know, people often ask about, what about Steve Jobs? Wasn't he sort of a hard ass in all of that? And of course he was. But, you know, don't forget those other two factors, macroeconomic factors and the business model. He was a genius, and he created a business model as a genius. Likewise, Jeff Bezos as Amazon. You know, when you have a unique business model that's first to market and is so powerful and all that, it can disguise a lot of leadership deficits. Think how even more successful Steve Jobs might have been had he been a person that was paid a little bit more attention to people and had a little bit stronger character habits. Second biography that came out about Steve Jobs shows that he did, in fact, evolve and change and become a more mature person and was a little bit stronger character habits. But he was a genius. So geniuses like that come along, you know, two or three times in the course of a century. One of Steve Jobs' direct reports is a guy named Ron Johnson. He was the one that managed the rollout of all the Apple retail stores and did a brilliant job under Steve Jobs' guidance when he did that. And after Jobs died, Ron Johnson left Apple, and he was recruited to become the CEO of JCPenney, which is a large retailer that was having a lot of real difficulty at that time. It was headquartered in Texas. He lived in California. Well, he immediately swooped in on his corporate jet every week, left his family there. He wasn't going to take any kind of commitment like moving his family to Texas to do this job. And he proceeded to be sort of a first-class jerk. He insulted he began by insulting the customer base. He claimed that JCPenney has been offering you these big, deep discounts too long. It's a bad habit you've got. Get over it. We're not going to do that anymore. And then he began to offend all of the senior executives there. Well, he was fired after 18 months. The board just basically, the stock plummeted and the performance of the company really went down. What Ron Johnson forgot is that he adopted Steve Jobs' abrasive asshole kind of management style, but he also forgot the factor is that he wasn't a genius like Jobs was. He forgot the genius part. So, anyway.
Yeah, I got a question. Andreas Hartwig, my name, from Living Diversity. And time and money always is an issue. And based on your studies, how much time would you say is required for this changing process, more or less?
Well, if you're talking about an individual level, you know, that can be a process that goes over months, is gradual, or it could be a rather immediate, dramatic one. You know, when I suspect that the average individual getting an in-depth report on their character habits, that I don't know what the percentage is, but I suspect that maybe half the things they learn, they think, that's I can fix that. I didn't have any idea that my sort of lack of attention about my schedule causes people to feel so disrespected. And when I have a whole series of people waiting outside my office and I'm constantly at a half an hour, 45 minutes late, I had I understood, we're all busy and all that. I didn't realize that people really take that as a real sign that I disrespect them as human beings, and people generally do. Other, you know, bad little habits like, you know, in the middle of a conversation looking at your smartphone. You know, I had somebody do that, a colleague of mine recently do that. I just stopped talking when he's doing that. And he says, I'm listening. You know, no, you're not. You're not listening. I'll wait till you're done and we'll have a conversation. Those little things communicate disrespect. Those are the kind of things that people can change immediately if they just become aware of it. But the more sort of deeper characteristics, like if your first response is to be angry and to be blaming when somebody makes a mistake that disappoints you, maybe a, you know, pretty dramatic mistake. If your first response is to be angry and blaming and all of that, that's a pretty unhelpful character habit. But it's also probably something that's pretty hard to change. But it can be changed.
Forgiveness has some relation with innovation.
Oh yeah.
Innovative compass, yeah. Capacity of a company.
Right.
But how do the four character dimensions, they play into each other? Could you, when you want to have your company become more innovative, you focus on that and you forget about integrity and responsibility? Or how does that play out?
You know, they're all highly correlated together. These are not independent variables or independent factors. But it is true that we found that there was a strong connection between senior teams that were viewed as being forgiving when well-intentioned people make mistakes and the level of innovation that people said was in the company of theirs. And it stands to reason. Nobody's going to risk their career by taking some sort of an innovative step if they think that there's a good chance that they'll be fired for having made a mistake or if their idea doesn't work out. So there's a real clear connection between these characteristics and innovation and collaboration and accountability, and all of these are, yes.
I'm Gabriella. Hi, I'm Gabriella. I'm a journalist and diversity consultant. I'm interested in some more data. Did you realize during the project any differences in size of the companies, in the age of the CEOs, or in the gender of the CEOs, or any other differences? Or the results were more or less the same?
We were able to sort on age of the CEO, for example, and tenure. And when you look at, you know, pull out those that have the greatest tenure versus those that have the least tenure, it did not follow through. There were no great differences in return on assets. So we looked at some of those different qualities. We didn't have a large enough sample of sectors. We had I think our largest sector was 17% was financial services. But that wasn't a large enough sample to compare that to the rest to see if there were any particular differences by sector. We did ask each of the CEOs in the study for their voting behavior. This is all American CEOs of who they had voted for in the past presidential elections going back. And it was interesting. They had no problem telling us. Of course, we gave everybody guarantees of total confidentiality, so they didn't mind telling us these kind of personal details. And we also asked them for their religious practices. And we found out when we looked at the data that out of those 84 CEOs, there were about 11 who claimed to have a weekly religious practice in their life that they honored. And they also, we found that there of those 11, we were also ones that were religious Republicans, that were, they were in our country, that's the conservative party, the Republican Party. And then we found that there was a set of Democrats that had voted 100% for Democratic candidates, a liberal candidate in the last several elections, and who were also professed to have no religious practices in their life at all. And then we looked to see if there's any difference. There's no differences on return on assets. There's no differences on workforce engagement levels. None of it. There were real jerks in both sides, religious Republicans and secular Democrats. There were really strong character people in both sides of them. But when you sort on characters, when you get those differences that pop out on workforce engagement and on return on assets. But so the lesson I took from that is that if you are in a leadership position, it doesn't matter what your religious practices are or your political beliefs are unless you talk about them. If you talk about them, by definition, you'll probably offend 50% of your workforce and your customer base, as some loudmouth CEOs in our country have learned lately by being vocal about things like gay marriage and all of that, and they've shot themselves in the foot.
Hi, I'm Juana. I'm a reputation management consultant and also an MBA student. I suppose your question partly answered, your answer partly answered my question, but I was interested in knowing if any of the CEO you interviewed were in large international corporations and if you were able to account for issues such as cultural sensitivity, cultural differences as part of.
Almost all, we had several large companies that were in our study, such as Costco, it was the largest. But other than Costco, they were almost all national companies, so that we did not grapple with the cultural differences. We are now rolling out our research in other cultures. We have a beginning research started in France, and also are looking to get it launched and find a sponsor to work with us in Germany. And we have a Latin American country that we're starting. So we assume there will be some certainly cultural differences. What won't change is that the four moral principles will be the same, is that we just need to identify what are the behavioral indicators of integrity in Japan, for example, versus France, versus Germany, so that we can come up with this that is culturally specific. But you know, we know we can't just impose American behavioral indicators on the rest of the world. I mean, we may think we can, but that's part of the arrogance of Americans that I don't like.
Sorry, I was more interested in the perception of leadership when the leader is coming from a culture such as the US, for instance, as applied into an organization, let's say, mostly based in Asia or Africa. How does the workforce relate to leadership coming from a completely
different... How does what relate?
How does the workforce relate to leadership coming from a completely different culture?
You know, we just haven't gotten into that side of things enough to have an answer on it. I mean, I look forward to learning a lot more as we roll this out and begin to study the cultural differences. But, you know, it's certainly a big challenge for a Japanese leader to come in and be the head of a German unit, for example, which probably doesn't happen very often, but you know, these are, you know, in these large global companies, it's going to increasingly happen, and I don't know the answers.
I have one more question.
Yeah.
When it comes to abrasive leadership, I mean...
To what leadership?
Abrasive leadership, for example. It has been traced back to a lack of self-reflection. Lack of the ability of self-reflection. And I was wondering if your annual character audits have been shown any improvement on self-reflection skills or abilities?
Well, we don't have a large enough sample yet of individuals that we've done annual surveys on to really document how individuals change. We're making more headway on assessing the character of teams and finding out what are the strategies that teams use to improve their reputation scores. But individuals, we don't have enough of that data yet to answer the question. Sorry.
We have time for one more, I think. Yep.
Hi, my name is Donovan. Question I have, again, connecting to one of the other questions regarding cultural background and also roots, where you come from, where you're born. You touched on that quite early in your presentation, connecting when people are born and your connection to your mother, teaching you the cultural and the four cornerstones of your character. So I think looking at changing character, especially in global organizations where you have a diverse culture, doesn't that play a key factor then? And how did you assess that in your assessment to come up with your results?
Well, our results are really North American based. And so there isn't a lot of cultural diversity with regard to the 84 CEOs in our company, in our sample. You know, the biggest diversity was gender. There's like 11 women in the study, but there's not a lot of culture. The one person of color in the study, one with Asian roots, but it's not a culturally diverse sample. And we realize that as we roll out the research. But what we think is the anchor point is that these universal moral principles are honored in each culture, and we just need to define them that are culturally specific in other cultures.
Just to finish off, one more question. How would you start this journey in a global company?
How do you start the journey in a company? How do you start?
How would you start this journey in a global company if you would like to look at changing the character of your executives? Would you start with a CEO? Oh. Would you start with the leadership team?
You should start with the leadership team because this character audit does not focus on any individual. This is a new concept, and if you try to go into a company and say to the CEO, well, the place to start is to do a character audit of you, most CEOs will, most CEOs, when they hear about this, like the idea, but they want everybody else to have the character survey, not them. So, we don't even go there. We just go in and talk. And besides, the data supports that if you've got limited resources, you should invest it in the team and team effectiveness rather than an individual anyway. I think the age of individual coaching has sort of been overdone, and in spite of the fact that I'm one of the pioneers in that field and more or less helped create the field 40 years ago. The resources available should be spent on teams, and certainly that will lead to some individual work and individual coaching work, but it should be done always in the context of helping a team be more effective, because you can see the line of sight between team effectiveness, workforce engagement, and return on assets and profitability.
Thanks very much. Very interesting.
Thank you all.